Good morning. We are here once again to talk about the downfall of SFAI. This time we're going down into the nitty-gritty of what happened and the present day, although the history part of this turned out to be a lot more big than anyone expected. So unfortunately, we're gonna have to go back into a few other details, because despite the school gallivanting its long and proud history of all of its alumni at every possible opportunity they could, what you don't see is the long-standing tradition of bad management. But first, let's get started with some unresolved stuff, that being the list from last time, because I still wanted to talk about a few of the things on there. And I knew a few voices would end up popping miraculously out of nowhere once it became apparent that these things need to be talked about that happened at the school, good and bad. So I'm picking the more important details to go over and understand all of this, which means, again, I'm going to have to skim over some details, but have no fear, because I've compiled a very nice numbered list for you to see everything with sources and dates. This is also a not so fortunate recap of the last video. So now that all of that's out of the way, let's go ahead and talk about... So a hot topic for the spring 2020 was how SFAI was missing its 990s tax information, which should be publicly available to anyone because it's a institution. What we found, however, was...
NOTHING!
And the entire time, the board and the admins were giving the runaround to all of this. They really didn't want people to find out about tax years 2016 and 2019. Or at the very least, they just weren't publicly available due to an audit, supposedly. So why is it important that this tax information is even available to us? For one thing, it does help prevent students from walking into situations where they get the rug swept out from under them, similar to all of these institutions. This is also to ensure that the school keeps its nonprofit status, something that helps provide funds to the school from the federal government. And these records have to be provided when they are requested, which is why it seemed kind of weird that no one could seem to find them. Maybe they just kind of got lost in the garden. So the worst case scenario of all this is that the finances were kept a secret because there were questionable payments that were made, or perhaps the donations that were made in a certain name were put in the wrong place. We can't really be sure. But that's just the worst case scenario, you see. There's no way anything nefarious could be going on with how they're handling their funds. I mean, we gotta have faith in the board, you guys. And the best case scenario is that they just have not been cohesive in their finances at all for the past 10, 20 years. Whoever knows how long this has all been going on. Although even just this past year, there were some things about money that was promised to be somewhere or to be given some at some point that just never showed up. For example, raising money for the international students when CARES money was cut off from them, using donations for international students, printing the graduate catalog, which still has not been printed out at all. But I was told to be less mean. And so let's pretend in this fictional world of money doesn't quite matter. But wait a second, a layman might say, what about Fort Mason? That shiny, beautiful piece of property that was supposed to get a new renter and therefore raise money for the school. Well, I've got some bad news for all of you buddos. While it was stated multiple times how Fort Mason could provide additional revenue for the school, at this point with the loan amount and interest that will accrue, Fort Mason has become a major liability, especially considering how the design doesn't allow for functionality outside of art, thereby scaring off any potential clients to lease it out. And with the deadline of having to start making payments on the UC loan to get back the Chestnut campus approaching in the fall, they might end up selling it instead for just a fraction of the cost. Although one of the board members had financial benefits from having the graduate studios be located at Fort Mason. Okay, so now all that's out of the way. Let's just ignore that too. So let's instead look at, historically the board's never been good, or at least that's the excuse I'm always hearing about. And it's certainly interesting to look back and see how the board and the administration operated in some sense. And even looking at how they took umbrage with students speaking out even 10 years ago, even threatening to arrest them for something as simple as putting chalk in the quad back some 10 odd years. And it also doesn't help that the board members, or at least the ones that were still there 2 months ago, were engaged in, let's say, some extreme neoliberalism.
Art Detective Forever, aka Jeremy Stone, aka SFAI board member, aka Gaslighting Queen.
What in the world are you talking about? The semester has ended. How can you continue to try to play victim when everyone is focused on George Floyd and police brutality? Hashtag Black Lives Matter.
Sammy Catrona in response. At Art Detective Forever, I'd be honored to present you with the award for Best Performance of White Guilt, Virtue Signaling, and Gaslighting. You and your colleagues on the board have done an outstanding job of showing SFAI students and alum what true performance art looks like. Congrats! What are you doing for the Black community beyond a hashtag on Instagram? What organizations have you donated to personally? No one chose to disassemble a sanctuary. You know the facts.
At Art Detective Forever, the students are not playing the victim. You have a seat on the board of a historically radical school as a white individual on a predominantly, if not all, white board, trying to envision a new school after having fired people of color during a mass pandemic, including student workers. Now you exclude all students, including Student Alliance, which is a diverse group of student representatives ranging in gender, age, and race, from having a voice in the future vision. Doesn't a school need students? And does that re-envisioned SFAI not include the voices of students and people of color? And now you speak to us so candidly as a privileged white individual after some of us are no longer paying for classes. Did you forget the summer students saying we are playing the victim? Is that not what you are doing right now? Playing the victim and using the Black Lives Matter movement as a cover-up for us calling you out? Because right now, what have the students done wrong? Fight too hard for our education, support our community from within with mutual aid, pack up studios for fellow faculty and students? You are definitely not the victims. And what we ask now is for SFAI to reflect in solidarity on their cruel and indifferent actions and donate to the Black Lives Matter movement.
In response to Sarah Becker. The SFAI students have done nothing wrong. The spring has been tragic for all of the SFAI community.
The staff and faculty are suffering layoffs and far worse economic ramifications of bad decisions by an irresponsible president without any interest in transparency. The board is dealing with decisions we had no power and knowledge of. As a former SFAI staff member and SFAI visiting faculty, I fought long and hard against these layoffs and the changes that were necessary. On your latest attack front, any individual and corporations can donate to BLM and related organizations, not a nonprofit struggling to pay staff and faculty through the summer. I have been raising scholarship funds for SFAI and other nonprofit organizations for 30 years. This is the worst time I have ever seen, and I am heartbroken for the students who have their studies interrupted, the staff, and the faculty. The upcoming Tuesday SFAI board meeting will be voting to make all meetings open and transparent to the SFAI community. Mike Henderson is on the board. Stop tokenizing Black people. I went to grad school and all I got was blocked by Jeremy Stone on Instagram.
Meaning on a large scale, they were willing to proclaim that they stood for equity and accessibility and such, but in the end, they weren't really willing to offer it to anyone who wasn't a higher up.
It also doesn't help that unlike other institutions, the SFAI Board of Trustees are self-appointed, meaning that they don't need to make consistent donations to the school to have a seat. They just need to be allowed into the club.
It was even funnier when students who returned the previous month, sometime in June last year, when they were dropping off a check, were told by security not to come along unannounced or they would be arrested. So, you know, this whole facade of saying they stood for equity and such was just tone deaf considering how they had the police on speed dial. So every time management is brought up, the excuse always seems to be, well, it's never been good. Like, it's just never been as good as it should be, as if that's an actual valid excuse. So what if the mayor has been poisoning our water supply by pissing in it? So have all the other mayors who've done it. So what if my boyfriend cheated on me? He cheated on everyone else he's been with, so it's just to be expected at this point. So what if an alumni was a KKK member who also seized lands from the indigenous people of America? I need you all to understand that just because something happened before in the past, that does not immediately justify the let's move on narrative. You see, because we have this thing called accountability. But again, let's pretend that the excuse of let's not worry about the past, let's move on guys, let's not worry about that, is a valid take. Very stupid take, but whatever. All right, so let's look at the board members now, because they've been doing what they've been calling the board listening tour 2021, which is just them sitting in a Zoom call with whoever is willing to sit there and screech at them. And for them to essentially sit there and go, we hear you, we understand. We understand you're mad, we understand you're upset. Please keep telling us how much you're upset. And I did take a peek into the adjunct meeting just to see what they had to say, which was
nothing.
A couple of people there, including union members, said explicitly that the board and the administration needed to take action on change rather than promise change, you know. Something that would warrant us to stop looking daintily to the past and instead think about the future with something more promising. Though I doubt they'll get very far if Pam has anything to say about that.
Fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, fuck all of you, fuck you all, I hate you all, and I hope the bad things happen in your lives.
But no worries. The current board are doing their best despite Pam's final promise.
Still, their financial records continue to be sealed even with the Reimagine Committee's request to see it. The models presented during the Reimagine Committee's presentations were actually based on estimations and what they consider to be the best case scenario, which also means that they might be worthless.
Well, the board are once again just sitting on their hands, just waiting for money to fall into their laps. Well, I'm sure the administration at least has made some decent changes, right? Right? Well, let's go ahead and take a look at
Hey,
the administration are the higher-ups for the school. Think of the president, the COO, half a dozen VPs for some reason at one point that never, for a school that never had more than 300 students. And historically, SFAI hasn't exactly had good administration either. This includes a president who was actively embezzling money. But the thing is, the administration, other than the president, have mostly been the same. Meaning they've all just been really bad at running a school. And the president is usually the one who ends up taking the fall for it. But what about that day-to-day activity and such? Surely the admins were able to see the writing on the walls and see that students were unhappy and do something about that, right?
A while back, there was a report written by
Not appearing in this film.
It was hard to find out why students were unhappy and understand retention rates. Many students in the Student Alliance felt that this was unnecessary since many of the issues spoken on, such as housing and food insecurity, were often discussed in Student Alliance meetings with Student Affairs. And in terms of retention rates, that also fell under the financial struggle of secondary education in general. While the staff made huge strides in getting financial issues solved on an individual level, the large-scale problem of inequality that new students faced each year was one of the contributing factors on why students chose to leave. On top of the, let's say, aggressive acceptance rates made by SFAI.
I did think admissions was like probably being too aggressive at certain points.
Like I would see the whole thing. Were you at SFAI when somebody was like posting like posters around saying like the acceptance rate is 95% or whatever?
I just was like, you know, there's some people who are there who are taking out the loans and I'm like, it's so clear. You're not ready for this. And I was like, admissions needs to not let those people in because, you know, you're talking about that level of debt for something that, you know, unless it's the right place for you, it's really the wrong place for you. Like, it's not an across the board because you can't be like, you know what? What was I thinking? Like, I actually need to be a graphic designer because, like, I, you know, want to make a different type of income and blah, blah, blah.
Despite the admission strategies, this financial struggle was felt in the classroom.
Seeing that and like hearing that around and then seeing how students kind of felt, it felt like people didn't want to be there. And so, I don't know.
As like enrollment drops, you know, you really start to feel like there's this, it starts to feel like in a lot of other places, right? The inequality we see it everywhere. And so you start to have this sense of working in, you know, this invisibly segregated classroom where it's not clear to me who's here on a free ride because they got a full scholarship, who's here on a free ride because their parents or their families can afford it, and who's here because they are passionate about something and willing to take on significant financial risks.
I had students in the class that were, you know, having issues with the school, you know, so I knew the school was not functioning at its peak, you know.
That tension started to become very concerning for me as a teacher, because what is assessment under those conditions when students are sort of operating in very different economic worlds, even though they're at the same school at the same time.
But the part that really was hard for me was just knowing that a lot of these kids who were in my classes were going to drown in the debt.
You know, I mean, I think this is also like what's important to realize is like, there are lots of people who go to college who don't have to go to college to maintain their class position. Their class position is maintained for them by a legacy that they inherit, right? And then there are people for whom like a college degree is part of building security, right? Where security doesn't exist. And those two things, again, are very different, but you have both kinds of students, right, in the mix at the school. And I think that like that really very different relationship to survival makes for different understandings of the purpose of art.
The financial inequality is just a single drop in the cesspool of student unhappiness. Although the necessary resources in regards to the type of students that were being accepted also coincided with the class status of those students. Accepting younger students and lower class students meant more support systems were necessary. except the problem was that there was no money to feed into those systems and the school was still needing to function.
Right before or after the first semester, I had left the dorms because they were charging like $2,100 or $2,200 a month. And I was like, I can't afford this anymore.
I also had times where there would be people from like the finance office coming to my class to hunt down people to pay like fees and stuff like that during my class, which felt really inappropriate.
Well, when I tried to leave, they were like, no, you have to pay the $2,500. And I'm like, I'm leaving here to try to get a better place, or not a better place, a cheaper place so I can afford to live in San Francisco. But they still charged me the $2,500. I don't know. And then like, you know, 2 months later, they're kicking everybody out of the dorms because of coronavirus. So if I didn't leave, I would have screwed myself because I wouldn't have had a place to live. But at the same time, like I was out $2,500. So either way, SFAI was going to screw me over. So just like, you know what I mean? Like there was no winning.
The lack of events specifically for our community actually being held at our school was really disappointing. I felt like that could have been pushed a lot harder by the administration and board.
And this was just one of the main problems with the school. It was focused on how to get more students rather than how to retain students.
And I definitely heard welcome student lectures, like, welcome students, we're so excited, which is true and real. But it's like this investment will pay off, you know, real like sugarcoating about what this level of debt will do to a person unless they have independent money. So I thought, I was like, no matter what else, fundamentally, that is not looking out for people. Like you guys are at different, you have different agendas.
I think that I wonder if people who have, you know, an abundance of class privilege understand how risky it has gotten out here for the rest of us.
And so if the admins who are running the school can't even talk to the students, it's no surprise that the retention rates started to drop the way they did. Although there are a few other, let's say, problems that also don't help the school's image. For those who are not familiar, Title IX is a law that serves to prevent gender-based violence and harassment that occurs on campus grounds. Infamous example would be the Brock Turner case, for instance. And it doesn't just cover students and extends out to anyone on campus. This includes the staff, faculty, and visitors. I'd like to think that SFAI is in a special situation since it's stretched out between 3 different locations, but who knows? And this being an art school that definitely gets weird and sexy, there's arguably a gray zone when it comes to the artwork. Except that gray zone was used plenty of times to justify on not following through with charges.
Especially like hearing stories about like people who have accused others of sexual harassment, and then those situations were not handled properly. From what I heard, I mean, nothing directly happened to me or my friends, but from the stories I heard about cases like those that happened there, I think a lot of it was like talk for like what they were actually saying when they were trying to advocate for students.
I would have like really intense problems with students. I had students that had major interpersonal issues with each other, of like harassment and things like that, where I was like, this is beyond what I can help with, you know, because it's like, this needs to go up higher up the chain. And so I would talk to Yasmin about it. And that was like my only, and usually I would go and she would basically be like, oh, well, it is what it is. And there would be nothing. I mean, I've really had like times I had times where I had students who were having severe problems with each other, and that was the times when I felt just completely unsupported. I had a student drop a class because of another student and had nothing to say to anyone. I'm just like being dropped into sometimes like an extremely like storied problem that spans multiple classes in the new genres department where, you know, I'm just on my own to try to figure out how to manage this thing that I think probably needed like mediation and administrative intervention and all this stuff, and just had nothing.
Obviously, I won't name the victims or the perpetrators, but hearing about past cases in confidence of experiences that took place, it's a wonder how it happened so often with no accountability.
One concern that even came up with the school closing was what happened to the cases at all, because Student and Academic Affairs, the offices that interacted the most with students, whittled down to 3 or 4 staff members, and at this point are non-existent. And there was no one to oversee the cases except the facilities manager, who most students hadn't even heard of.
I don't even know who that is.
How could this happen to me? I made my mistakes, got nowhere to run.
But Electric Kazoo, you might be saying, we don't have time to care about any of those students.
Shut up!
According to SFAI's own Title IX regulations, everyone hired must report something if it involves Title IX. And it is from there that the Title IX coordinator must take the necessary actions for the students. Well, okay then, I guess I'll just talk to the coordinator, I guess.
We're sorry. A long distance company access code is required for the number you have dialed. Please dial your call with the access code.
Well, that was disappointing. But again, let's just say that I'm being unfair somehow. Well, I guess we can just call ahead. Oh.
How could this happen to me? I made my mistakes, got nowhere to run. The night goes on as I'm fading away.
Well, in that case, I guess I just gotta start following up with students whose cases were not followed up on, maybe. Well, that was disappointing. Now, I'm not saying that the school decided to use the chaos and withdrawing of students to take care of any legalities that could pose a problem, but the school totally decided to use the chaos and withdrawing of students to take care of legalities. But Electric Kazoo, you might be saying. Those were just previous students who are technically alumni now, but you know what? No, they don't matter. Don't worry about them. They're totally fine with having their cases thrown out. Don't worry about that. We need to focus on the students now. You know what? That's a good point.
Bringing back the whole point earlier in the video, I spoke with a few current students who don't want to be named and found that the board and the administration still refuses to be clear on what's going on at the school, especially on how far they can go as they run on fumes. One student said they learned everything going on with the school through the faculty, and for students who are still at the school and have only 1 or 2 semesters left, it was either stay at SFAI or risk transferring out and working for an extra year in the school because of credits not transferring fully, which most students are still feeling the brunt of.
Like, we were paying money, and then you're just gonna kick me out, and now my credits are useless. Like, who the hell has a new genres program? Freaking nobody. That is, like, a one-of-a-kind, like, I could go to, like, Otis College or something. You know, all those random schools, but it's, you know, none of that stuff's gonna transfer, so it's just, it wasn't a waste of time. I enjoyed my time, but.
When I was in high school, I had toured SFAI, and I was like, I wanna go to this school one day, and then I ended up going there. So yeah, it's like I did have like unrealistic expectations of like what they were saying it would be. Like they were obviously trying to seem way more progressive than they actually are, because that's just like how most schools are, especially UCs, who are like, oh, we advocate for students, but we want cops on campuses.
Obviously this wasn't because of COVID. Oh my God, I felt like everybody was like, this is not real, but like how handy to use COVID. I mean, this was not because of COVID. This was financial disaster, mismanagement, and then incomplete. Like I remember all of these faculty meetings with Gordon, and this was before it closed. And it was like, you know, big words, big words, big words, big words, big words. And then, you know, this rumor that we're gonna merge with I think it was USF. And it was like, we're gonna, you know, the most important thing is the cultural heart of SFAI, and we need to like preserve the integrity and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, you know, I did think because the words were so emphatic and so like moving forward that I did not appreciate the level of danger the school was in. I did notice like, where are the students? Because it was legitimately too quiet. I was like used to a different bustling atmosphere. But during that time, I wouldn't say shocked because I knew things were going wrong, but I was really, really, really angry that COVID was being spoken about as the thing that killed the school. And I was like, no, you guys were talking about mergers because you were financially dying beforehand, but without actually saying we're financially dying.
It was just hard. I don't know. Like, they were lying to us. Now, and then they still admitted new people. Somebody said they admitted like a freshman that hadn't had any credits. And they said they were only going to have people that were like close to graduating. So it's like, well, if you're going to cut corners for this one person, now it's like, you guys are just lying to our face. Like,
I mean, I kind of think they're just hoping this, like, this would be my guess, that this generation of students and players kind of goes away and then they can rebrand and like move on with like fresh people who are not embittered, basically.
And even though they continued to flaunt how they stayed open because of donations, it was also due to the fact that they were contractually obligated to pay the tenured faculty for a year, meaning this year was their absolute last chance to make any sort of money. And yet, they still say they're open.
I mean, every time I see it, I'm like, what? You're still there? I have gone to the website. I'm like, you're accepting applicants? Like, I can hardly talk through that. I'm like, I don't know why. They are still, I know they're like the building and you have to be in art school or it gets turned over to Berkeley and like, but now you can't sell the mural. So how, you know, all this, I know there's like all of that shit show behind the scenes around maybe why they're still, they have students like on campus, but it doesn't make any sense to me whatsoever how they are functioning.
It doesn't make sense to me either. There's got to be someone who could give me the answers somewhere, but where?
SFAI is going to blow up in smoke and everything's going to go to hell and it's going to turn into like a YouTube video, you know, just like
all the irony.
Oh yeah, that's true. I mean, they did not say that, but they were like, that's not the soul.
I guess really that they should just go fuck themselves.